I'm Geraldo Rivera, and now it can be told.
It's another Silence of the Lambs, but this one is real. It stars accused urban cannibal Jeffrey Dahmer and the man he had marked as his 18th victim.
He told me I would never leave him. When he eat a part of my heart, I would be a part of him. He would be a part of me.
Today, exclusive, the luckiest man in America retraces the footsteps that nearly led him to a horrible death.
And I kicked him, you know, kicked him in the face, like, and then he just, like, went back. And then I ran for the door.
Now it can be told, the waking nightmare of the man who got away. For the first time, the lost photos that launched a legend and the secret letter that tells the incredible story behind them. You'll meet Marilyn Monroe's forgotten sister and learn how Ronald Reagan unwittingly turned a factory girl into a film goddess. Now it can be told, the Lost Picture Show.
Welcome, everybody. Those stories later. Up front today, the explosive Middle East. Once again, we watch and we wait as the war of words between President Bush and the butcher of Baghdad threatens to degenerate into bombs, bullets, and blood. In the meantime, the fate of the 10 Western hostages held in Lebanon hangs in the balance. After much speculation that they were about to be released, a pro-Iranian kidnap faction announced the other day that the cruel captivity would continue, at least until Israel frees more of its Arab prisoners. But just where are our people, and exactly who's holding them? Now it can be told.
The hostages are being held by several groups with allegiance to Hezbollah, an extremist Shiite organization with direct ties to Iran. They are violently anti-West, anti-American, and anti-Israel. This is the Bekaa in East Lebanon, home of the world's most dangerous terrorist organizations, including Hezbollah. Baalbek is the center of Iranian operations in Lebanon. Ayatollah Khomeini still stares down on the place. The city is ringed by Syrian troops, who are onlookers, because Syrian policy is not to egg on the Shiites directly, because of fear of a war with Iran, or of getting the hostages killed. This is the Sheikh Abdullah Barracks, where intelligence sources confirm several of the hostages are being held right now.
Well, the hostages have been held at a number of places, but principally at two places, at the Sheikh Abdullah Barracks and in Baalbek, which is a city in the eastern part of Lebanon, which is in the heart of the poppy-growing and drug-growing area. That town has been under the control of the Syrians for many years right now, but it has been essentially garrisoned by various elements of various Iranian-backed terrorist groups, and actually some Iranian regulars, we believe, in the past.
This is the observation tower with radio antenna, the administration and military headquarters, where communications are sent to Beirut and the rest of Lebanon. The main barracks house 150 soldiers. This is part of the Sheikh Abdullah complex. Highly informed sources confirm that beneath this three-story building, hostages are being held in an underground jail. These plans show us the position of their prison, the barracks, the watchtower, all of which is surrounded by landmines. This man, Hussein Moussaoui, a former school teacher in Beirut, is now operations chief of Hezbollah. He lives in Baalbek and is in command of the Western hostages held by his organization. Moussaoui is now a major player in the current hostage negotiations.
Back here in the United States, terrorism expert Neil Livingston tells us that in the ongoing negotiations, the Bush administration is worried about Israel, the one country that has steadfastly refused to deal with terrorists like Hussein Moussaoui.
There are people within the government right now, the U.S. government, that are deeply upset by what's going on, and even some people at state. And they tell me that they're deeply concerned about the Israeli position, that the Israelis they look to be tough, to be strong, not to make concessions to terrorists. And what they're seeing is that the Israelis are willing to give up the shop, if you will, perhaps to get seven bodies back, or perhaps to get, at most, one living Israeli back.
Joining us now from Jerusalem via satellite is Israel's former ambassador to the United Nations. He is now deputy foreign minister, a familiar face to American television audiences from his frequent appearances during the Gulf War. This is Benjamin Netanyahu. Welcome, Mr. Minister.
Thank you.
What would your brother, Jonathan, your slain brother, the hero of the raid on Entebbe, what would he say about Israel now apparently negotiating with terrorists over the fate of these hostages?
Well, I think we better have a clarification of terms before I answer that. We're negotiating for the release of our own POWs and MIAs in exchange for prisoners that we hold. We're not negotiating the release of convicted terrorists in Israeli jails who have actually carried out terrorist operations against civilians. That's not happened.
You mean those people in the prisons are non-negotiable? You will not release them?
No, we have no plans on doing that, no.
How do you have any proof that your guys are even still alive?
Well, until very recently, we didn't know anything. Now we appear to know about three. We're still lacking the most basic information about another four.
On those three, are they alive?
No, I'm afraid of two we can say with, we can definitely say that they are dead, and there's a possibility, a strong possibility, that the third one is dead. When I say dead, it looks like that at least one of them was murdered in captivity.
Would you release your prisoners in exchange for seven dead bodies then?
You know, I think there's information, not complete information, but pretty reliable information that at least some of the POWs are alive. And I wouldn't want to say on this or any other program or any other communication to say, give me bodies, because they might proceed and do that.
Right.
Turning some live people into bodies.
I hear you.
But what we want is an accounting, a full and truthful accounting of the present condition of our missing men. And we would like to have them all brought back to Israel. The live ones alive, and of course the dead bodies brought back for burial. And that's where we're prepared to pay a very high price, but not any price, to have them come back home.
How about Sheikh Obeid? Is he part of the price? Will he be released?
He is. He is. At the end, yes. If we receive all our men back home, then Sheikh Obeid goes home.
Quickly, last question. Are you getting intense pressure from the United States and the other Western powers to make this deal happen?
No. I have to say that on this, there's not been any significant pressure, and certainly no pressure from the United States. That's refreshing, because usually Israel, never took a hostage in its life, is always the table is somehow reversed, and Israel is always to blame. And the there's a spree of Israel bashing in some of the world media, exempting your program and of course the other good guys and so on. But the main point that I'm saying is, from the American government, there has been no pressure whatsoever, and maybe that's why this thing is proceeding, because when you leave the parties to deal with each other, you can actually get a better result than if you try to influence or tamper with the pressure from without.
Mr. Netanyahu, thank you very much. We'll be right back with the man who escaped the cannibal killer.
Today, exclusive, the luckiest man in America retraces the footsteps that nearly led him to a horrible death.
And I ran for the door, and God had to be with me, right?
The man who got away is next. And later, we'll show you Marilyn Monroe's lost portfolio.
Welcome back. For weeks, the country has been spellbound by the horrifying story of Jeffrey Dahmer. The Milwaukee maniac has admitted killing and dismembering 17 men. He has pleaded innocent by reason of insanity.
His neighbors smelled the stench. Some wondered about the whine of a power saw. No one suspected the man inside could really be a killer, not to mention a cannibal. For 13 years, this madman committed unspeakably heinous acts. Then, 2 months ago, a 32-year-old potential victim escaped his clutches.
Our correspondent Craig Rivera went to Wisconsin for this exclusive talk with the man who broke this case wide open at the very place where it happened.
Geraldo, it's from this mall in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, that Jeffrey Dahmer lured his last victim, Tracy Edwards, into his house of horrors. That July day marked the end of one of the most disturbing killing sprees in U.S. criminal history, but it also marked the beginning of Tracy Edwards' worst nightmare. Today, this father of five relives his encounter with a madman.
And he made me sit on the couch like, and he had pictures of kids he had cut up, and it looked like they had took big bites out of him and stuff, you know? Yeah, it was sick, really. Yeah, And then really I knew that I was in a life and death situation.
Tracy knew Dahmer casually from the neighborhood.
So he looked like a normal guy.
Yeah, normal everyday person. Yeah, really.
Do you ever talk to him before that day?
As far as speaking, when he saw us hanging outside or something, he'll speak a couple times, say, hello, what's up, guys, you know, and keep going, you know. But never a conversation until I got here in the mall.
The mall was a common hangout for Tracy and his friends. They talk, drink beers, pick up girls. So when Jeffrey Dahmer asked to join the group, pretending he was new in town, Tracy had no reason to be suspicious, even though Dahmer offered to foot the entire bill for the evening.
Had a big old bankroll full of money. I said, yeah, we get girls, we go to the lake or whatever. He said the expenses are on him.
Tracy made plans to meet his friends later. They would join up at Dahmer's apartment, where Tracy agreed to go for a drink. When they stopped here for liquor, Dahmer gave Tracy's friends the wrong address.
He was telling my friends a totally different place to come. It wasn't even the correct address. They went there looking for us, and we wasn't there.
Dahmer led Tracy along this back route into his apartment building.
I said, God, man, what's that smell? And he said, it's a sewer problem. The management's supposed to be getting it straightened out, you know, but they haven't fixed it yet. Then we entered his apartment, you know, which he has several locks on the door, about 7 or 8 locks. Then I noticed a camera, and he said it was for security purposes, you know, because he had alarm on every door, you know, even leading into the bedroom, you know. I said, it's a pretty rough neighborhood. I didn't think anything about that either, you know. Yeah. And then he had got me a beer and fixed me a drink while he went to the back.
At first, Tracy thought it was the foul odor that was upsetting his stomach.
But now I know it'd probably be something he put in my drink.
Tracy's nightmare was just beginning.
Now, it happened so quick, and I don't even know where the knife came from. He must have had it on his sofa already in the handcuffs, already waiting inside the cushions or whatever. The next thing I know, bam, you know. There he was. You know, I had dropped beer and all, right? Because you know, at first I didn't know. I was shocked. I didn't know if he was for real or what, you know? And I asked him, well, what's going on, man, you know? And then he started telling me that he would kill me if I didn't do what he said do, you know? He had killed before, you know, and he would do it again if I didn't do everything he said.
So then what happened?
He's kind of got this knife, you know, like pointed at me. Then he, like, steers me to the refrigerator. Makes me open up the refrigerator, and then that's when I start seeing what skulls and whatever have you. Yeah. Oh, man. Yep, and then he told me mine was like much better than theirs.
Dahmer then led Tracy into his bedroom, where he showed him pictures of mutilated bodies and his storage drum of human remains.
He had a big barrel there, like a 55-gallon barrel, you know. Yep, and he walked me over to there, showed me different things. It was like limbs and a penis is hanging, just all types of body parts, you know. And I had to turn my head, and he was like, turn around and look, it's beautiful. And then he wants to lay across my chest. He asked me, could he put his head on my chest and listen to my heartbeat, right? He had a complex about people leaving me. He told me I would never leave him. When he eat a part of my heart, I would be a part of him. He would be a part of me. And then I got up from there, I hopped up real quick. I told him I gotta go to the bathroom again. And at that point, he didn't get up with me, okay? And then he had his head like hanging down a little bit. And then I said, yeah, this is the time now, right? And so as I was walking past the guy, I hit him, right? Hit him in the jaw and his head kind of turned over. And I kicked him, you know, kicked him in the face like, and then he just like went back. And then I ran for the door and God had to be with me, right? Because he had like 8 different locks on there. At that point, he only locked 1 padlock, you know, deadbolt lock, and I just picked the right lock out of all of them, you know, just like a blessing.
Tracy raced out of Dahmer's apartment, turned the corner, and flagged down a police car. The handcuffs were still dangling from his wrist. When they went back inside, the police saw for the first time the horrifying handiwork of Jeffrey Dahmer.
It could have been me there, you know, yeah, and just being so close to death, you know. I've been getting away from it. It made me realize how important life is, you know, how valuable it is, you know. So I'm not taking any day or any moment for granted.
If Dahmer walks on this case because of the insanity plea, there's going to be a revolution in Milwaukee. Tracy Edwards, you should know, is now suing the city of Milwaukee for $5 million due to the failure of police officers there to arrest Jeffrey Dahmer during an earlier May confrontation. Edwards himself is awaiting trial in Mississippi, we have discovered, on a sexual battery charge involving a 14-year-old girl. Edwards maintains his innocence.
We'll be right back with a new Marilyn Monroe story, told through lost photos, a secret letter in a forgotten system. Nearly three decades after her death, is it possible to discover anything new about Marilyn Monroe? Haven't we heard it all, seen it all? No siree. Take a look.
I got a fever and inflammation.
The year is 1961. Marilyn Monroe is the biggest bombshell to drop on the American public since Rita Hayworth.
Some like it hot.
Her unique brand of sex appeal has a potent effect on GIs, presidents, and a trio of husbands. Summer 1945. Captain Ronald Reagan of the U.S. Army's 1st Motion Picture Unit dispatches Private David Conover on a routine assignment to take pictures of women working in the war effort. As he moves down the assembly line at Radio Plane Corporation, he's stopped in his tracks by a beautiful girl he later describes as half child, half woman. She is Norma Jean Doherty, a 19-year-old with grease on her face and a propeller in her hand. Conover can't stop snapping. Soon the photos make their way to Hollywood, and a star is born.
I found a $1 million baby in a 5 and 10 cent store.
But these photos show Marilyn as she once was, a young girl waiting for life to happen. Before the tragedy, before the heartache, they capture one moment in time that truly created a star.
I found a $1 million baby in a 5 and 10 cent store.
What an incredible woman, the sex goddess of her time. Joining me now via satellite from Van Nuys, California, is Marilyn Monroe's often forgotten stepsister, B.B. Goddard. In 1937, Bibi's father married Marilyn's legal guardian. Marilyn, or as she was then known, Norma Jean, lived with Bibi on and off for the next 5 years. The two girls, who were almost the same age, stayed in touch until the mid-1950s. Bibi, welcome.
Hello.
Nice to see you. So did Marilyn, or Norma Jean, as she was known when you were teenagers living together, did she know she was destined for stardom?
No, she really didn't. I think it was beyond the realm of our imagination at the time, although she was a very, very special person and, of course, really incredibly beautiful even when she was so young.
Were you jealous of her good looks, Bibi?
No. That's really incredible, too. She was just so sweet, you could not be jealous of her. She was just the most adorable person.
When you received her letter, or actually the letter was addressed to your mom, to Grace. Did you guys feel that she was getting involved in the right thing, that Hollywood would be right for Norma Jean?
Yes. She was someone who should be shared with the world.
You really believe that?
Yes.
When you hear all the stories now about Marilyn having a lesbian lover, Marilyn having an affair with President Kennedy, Marilyn marrying this guy, Bob Slater, do you put any stock in that? Do you believe that?
I know for absolutely sure that she did not have any lesbian affairs. For the rest, I can't say of my own knowledge.
Okay, Bibi. We have to take a commercial break. When we come back, can you read from that letter?
Yes.
Okay, you'll share it with us. Okay. Bibi has that letter from Marilyn, the letter about the photos that you just saw, and Bibi will share the letter with us. In the meantime, those of you interested in seeing the pictures we just broadcast up close and personal will be able this week to visit the Circle Galleries of LA and San Francisco. We'll be right back. Marilyn Monroe's stepsister will be showing us her intriguing letter from her sister in a moment, but first a look at what's coming up on the next edition of Now It Can Be Told.
Anchors away! The Navy's been recruited by a bizarre New Age group.
It's a cult. It's from the bottom to the top. It's a cult.
And the Pentagon may be spending your hard-earned tax dollars to learn the teachings of John Roger, founder of the so-called Cadillac of cults.
You've been described as a guru who claims to be the equal of Jesus Christ.
Take your hands off my camera.
Has Uncle Sam been brainwashed? Now it can be told.
We're back with Bebe Goddard, Marilyn Monroe's stepsister. Okay, now in this letter that Marilyn wrote to your mom, to Grace, she talks about getting approached by this David Conover who took her pictures. Why don't you read right from the letter itself, Bebe?
All right, I'll pick up at a certain point after she has told about him. He called me at the plant one morning later and said that all the pictures came out perfect. Also, he said that I should by all means go into the modeling profession. He also said that I photograph very well and that he wants to take a lot more. Also, he said he had a lot of contacts in which he wanted me to look into. I told him I would rather not work when Jimmy was here, so he said he would wait. So I'm expecting to hear from him most any time again. He called not long ago and said he had a lot more prints for me to keep. He is awfully nice and is married and is strictly underlined business, which is the way I like it. Jimmy seems to like the idea of me modeling, so I'm glad about that. I'm going to ask David Conover for some more prints, and I'll send you some.
That's awfully nice, Bebe. Thank you. The Jimmy that she refers to, Jimmy Dougherty, Marilyn's
right.
First husband.
Yes.
She divorced him by 1945 or so?
46, actually.
46. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And she writes such cute letters, maybe a little ungrammatical, but very darling.
And so are you, Bebe, and thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
That letter and those exquisite photos, two more additions to the legend that is Marilyn Monroe, a woman whose image is as indelible and enduring now as it was during her life. That's it for now. I'm Geraldo Rivera.
And 10 cent store.